Ruchim Abayim, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Congregation Ahavas Yisroel, where tonight Chazaq is honored and privileged to host world-renowned lecturer Rabbi Mordechai Becher. Before we begin, I just want to publicly announce, apologize to the rabbi for accidentally leaving out the topic on the flyer, even though he asked me quite a few times. But I just want to tell the rabbi that people are not coming for the topic, they're coming for you, so it doesn't make a difference. Anyways, regarding upcoming events, every Monday night, Chazaq has women classes for ladies at the Beth Gavriel Center in Forest Hills. Tomorrow night, we're going to be having the renowned Pearl Abramowitz on parenting. The week after, Gitti Margaretin. The week after, we're going to be having the renowned Jackie Bitone. And the week after, we're going to be having Rabbitin Devar Kigel. So we have a whole lineup every Monday. Spread the word, ladies. Come, enjoy. It's great. Next week, Chazaq will be hosting Rabbi Fischel Schachter. The details are not confirmed 100%. You will be getting the emails, seeing the flyers, getting the text messages, whatever means of hearing about the events, you'll be definitely notified. Chazaq programming. Our newest program is Chazaq Radio. The idea for Chazaq Radio is as follows, that Baruch Hashem, the Jewish community is growing leaps and bounds. And unfortunately, when you want to hear news, there really isn't any source for that. So what we like to do is we like to fill in voids. And Baruch Hashem, just getting the idea of how it'll go, we just started with some music. All the great hits, all the world-renowned singers, Benny Friedman, Avram Fried, Mordechai Ben-David, Yaakov Shwaki. And believe it or not, Baruch Hashem, thousands of listeners are coming in. So it's definitely working, whatever we're doing. We started having shows once a week on Thursdays. Rabbi Schaefer on the Shmooze, Rabbi Bregman on the Parsha. I'm sorry? What's the station? So it's not on air yet. It's just online. It's chazakradio.com. So in Mirza Hashem, with Hashem's help, if we have any connections, if anyone knows anyone that could help us get on air, on a dial, on a station for 24 hours, something along the lines of 613 FM or something along those lines, we'll be more than happy to be on air. You'll talk to me afterwards. We have a sponsor of $10 million for a station. Woo! Oh, that's... We're speaking to them. Okay. We'll see him. It's Hashem. So anyway, so that's online for now. And Emir Hashem, the goal with this is that once he'll be on air as well as online, our goal is to have Chazaq TV as well, where we're going to be able to have functions as well. So all these shirim you can see on chazakradio.com. Listen to it. It's on torahanytime.com. It's online on YouTube. It's on JApp. It's which is a new app, a stream on the phones. And Baruch Hashem, we're getting our shirim worldwide. So even though we have whatever amounts of people, Baruch Hashem, a nice crowd tonight, these shirim are doubled and quadrupled in the hundreds and thousands, and they're forever. And many times the sponsors that do sponsor shirim, or if anyone has yard sites, we dedicate CDs and DVDs of these shirim, and we give them out as well. So Rabbi Becher, tonight you're not speaking in front of 100 or whatever amount of people. You're speaking in front of thousands of people, which is an amazing thing. So I could go on and on. I just want to make a public thank you. I just saw one of the guys coming, Yaakov Sura from the Queen Jewish Link, who's helping promote Chazaq events in his newspaper, and he does a big... He does deserve a round of applause for the only Queen's Jewish newspaper that goes door-to-door in Kew Gardens Hills. So he's in the crowd. And I wanted to thank the Shul, obviously, Sir Rabbi Welcher, Mark Frankel, and the whole, the president, Mr. Hochster, that's right, and the whole Shul for opening up its doors. I guess you heard enough for me. Without further ado, it's my honor to call upon Rabbi Mordechai Becher. Round of applause, please.
Thank you. I'll just put it down there. Out of consideration for those who are sleeping, just put them on vibrate or something. So welcome everyone, and also welcome to those who are listening on chazakradio.com. I'm sure you've heard many rabbis speaking, And Rabbonim often talk about Olam Haba. You often hear rabbis saying about things that you'll do which will guarantee you Olam Haba, things that that you should not do that will lose Olam Haba. There is a lot of talk about Olam Haba. And we mention it in davening, and we mention it in many, many places throughout our literature and throughout our liturgy. What is a little strange about this is the fact that, yes, rabbis mention it, and yes, we mention it in tefillah, and yes, it's mentioned in the Mishnah, but the one place where you'd hope, expect, and imagine that it should be mentioned, the Torah, it's not mentioned. There is literally not a word in the entire Torah, five books of Moses, Chamish and Chumash Torah, that says Olam Haba. What we are told is, if we do mitzvahs, it will rain at the appropriate time. Woo, that sounds weird. I mean, that, I guess you're living in Israel, rain is extremely important. But rain, right? We are told that we will have peace and security. Those are excellent, wonderful things. But it doesn't say in the Torah, if you do the mitzvahs, you will have Olam Haba. It does not say it. And it's a very, very strange thing, especially if you read the books of many religions, you'll find that they are replete with mentions of the world to come. The Christian scriptures, the Quran, and the Hadith, and Upanishads, and so on and so forth, many, many of the books of the texts of religions throughout the world discuss at length the ideas of Olam Haba. And the Torah, HaKadosha, does not talk about this. Granted, the Torah alludes to the idea. We are told that if a person does certain, there are certain averus, it says, V'nichrasa hanefeshahi avona ba, that soul shall be cut off from its nation, the sin clings to it. Now, clearly, that would indicate that the soul exists beyond death, apparently. It indicates that the sin is attached to the soul. It indicates the idea of a soul. And so that would seem to imply there is such a thing as an existence beyond this life. We are also told in the Torah that the terminology used for the death of a righteous person is interesting terminology. Two terminologies. One is shachav imavoisav, he lay down with his fathers. The other is ne'esaf el amav, gathered to his people. Both of those terms imply a community and an existence beyond this life. They imply that. But it is not explicit. And that seems to be disturbing. It bothers me. And obviously the Torah seems to be communicating something through its silence. Silence is a form of communication. You know, I remember I was sitting in Shir many, many years ago in the age of cassette recorders. Anyone remember those? Right, cassette recorder, right. So the 1900s, last century. So when I was young. So I was sitting there and Ramosha Shapiro was giving Shir. And people put their tape recorder, their cassette recorders on the table. And a guy puts his a brand new cassette recorder on the table. And every now and again, it makes a little clicking sound, which is a little annoying. So Ramosha Shapiro looks at it and he says, Ma ima klikaze. That's Hebrew. What's with the click? Ma ima klikaze. So the guy says, he replies in Hebrew, Ze voice operated recorder. That is Hebrew for voice operated recorder. And he says, Ksharav medabel zemaklit. When the rabbi speaks, it records. Ksharav shotek zemafsik. When the rabbi is silent, it stops recording. The guy was quite proud of this feature. And Rav Moshe Shapiro looks at him and he says, Chaval. Shtika zegam kein divrei Torah. He says silence is also part of the Divrei Torah. If we would communicate without any pauses whatsoever, no silence, no gaps, nothing, that would not be a coherent communication. Silence is a form of communication as well. And when Rav Moshe Shapiro pauses, he wanted that to be on the tape too. So the voice operator recorder, I'll translate, the voice operator recorder was not getting that. And that's what silence is. There was actually a famous Rebbe who was known as the Rebbe of silence. He communicated by silence. There was a story, a close friend of his came to see him. They hadn't seen each other for 20 years. He sits down, he looks, they look at each other, and the silent Rebbe says, "No." And the other one says, "No, no." And the Rebbe says, "Oy." And the other guy says, "Oy." And he leaves. And that was it. Right? 20 years. It was enough. That was enough. Someone asked the silent Rebbe where he learnt silence from. He didn't answer. So obviously, silence tells you something. You know, if you ask your kid who did that and they're silent, it might be an indication of something. Not automatically do I not automatically assume guilt, but I'm usually right. So silence. So if the Torah is silent about Olam Haba, if the Torah doesn't, I mean, it's clear that the Torah deliberately doesn't mention it, it avoids mentioning it. It, on the contrary, it gives us rewards in this world. It talks about punishments, Chalila, in this world. It does not talk about Olam Haba, even though it appears to be a central idea in the Torah, in Judaism, from Chazal. We know from the Neviim such an idea. So what's the meaning of this? So I want to offer you, this is not my question. This is a question that was asked by 8 of the Rishonim, medieval scholars, summarized at length by the Abarbanel in Parashas Bechukosai, and the Kli Yakar, who summarizes the Abarbanel summary, because anyone who knows Abarbanel will know that his summary is about as long as a book of most people. So the Kli Yakar, right, Rav Yosef Ephraim Lunshitz summarizes it in his commentary, for those who want to have a look at it. I'm always amazed. Summer is coming along, so you know, we're thinking of vacation. I'm always amazed by Rav Yosef Ephraim Lunshitz was the actual, Shlomo Ephraim Lunshitz, sorry, he was the Rosh Yeshiva in Prague, not long after the time of the Maharal. He experienced horrific headaches, terrible headaches, migraines, really bad migraines. He went to a doctor, and the doctor said to him that the strain of teaching Gemara, teaching Talmud, was too much for him. And that's why he was getting he needed to take a vacation. Take a break, the doctor says, take a break. It's the type of prescription you want to hear from the doctor. Take a break, take a vacation. So the doctor says, so he took a vacation. So during the vacation, he wasn't teaching Gemara. He wrote a commentary on Chumash. I don't know what you did last summer, right? We were in China. But anyway, but again, you know, that's not bad. So the Kli Yakar summarizes it. So I'm going to give you a number of different approaches from our sages regarding why this phenomenon, why is it that the Torah doesn't talk about it? The first approach is that of the Rambam. The Rambam, Maimonides, doesn't address it directly, but he does address it. And he says the following. He says, you know, the Torah wants us to do that which is good. Why? Not because I will get some points. Not because I will get reward. The Torah wants us to do good because it is good. It wants us to avoid evil because it is evil. To do that which is good because it is good. To do that which is noble because it is noble. To pursue truth because it is true. Not because we're always looking at what the reward and punishment is. He says, therefore, by not giving the ultimate reward and punishment in the Torah itself, the Torah is directing our eyesight, directing our aim away from reward and towards an understanding of doing that which is good because it is good, is what we call altruism. To do things lishma. It is true. It is better to do the right thing, shelo lishma, not for ideal reasons, than not to do it at all. But better than both is to do it for the ideal reason. Really, we should, and the truth is, this is true not only about Torah mitzvahs, but lahavdil, in many areas of life, this is true. You know what I mean? It's we know you can teach a child how to paint, how to read, and sometimes in order to get them to actually read or to do learn their ABCs or learn the basics of maybe music or the basics of painting or etc. You have to bribe the child. You offer them incentives. But at a certain point, when the child actually learns how to read, how to play piano, how to paint, etc., at a certain point, do they need incentives anymore? Or do they appreciate the thing in and of itself for what it is? Obviously, at a certain point in time, they're going to appreciate it for what it is. That is what HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants from us in terms of the mitzvahs. The Rambam says he wants us to do the mitzvahs because they are true, because they are good, not because we're getting reward. And there's an amazing story I heard from Yossel Tzeinver of Yerushalayim, who tells a story, there's not a well-known story, about the Chafetz Chaim. If you all heard of the Chafetz Chaim, I'm sure. So the Chafetz Chaim walks into some hotel lobby in Poland somewhere. I don't know if they had lobby, but whatever. All stories in Poland, all Hasidic stories throughout, they always involve an inn and usually an innkeeper, etc. Whatever. So there's a hotel lobby. There's a group of Jews standing there in the lobby, and they're talking to each other and they're laughing their heads off. So the Chafetz Chaim looks at this scene and he says to himself, doesn't look like they're talking words of Torah, because why are they laughing? He says, it does not see, that highly unlikely they're speaking about business. Jewish businessmen in Poland in the 19th century, in the 20th century, nothing to laugh about. Politics, nothing to laugh about unless the local dictator died. But I mean, generally, right, there's nothing to laugh about. Right, so they're standing there, so the Chafetz Chaim comes to the reluctant conclusion that they are possibly speaking about someone who's not there. Lashon hara. Evil speech. So he walks over to them in a tremendous act of courage, and he says, excuse me, my name is Yisroel Meir Kagan. And they say, hi, yeah, we're just in the middle of a conversation here. He says, I just wanted to tell you that, ask you that if you are talking about another Jew, please change the topic. So they look at him and they say, You walk into our conversation, you ask us to change the topic? Are you kidding? So Chafetz Chaim says, no, I'm just a Jew who's concerned that you should not be speaking badly about another Jew. And one of them says, I've heard of you. You say Yisroel Meir Kagan? He says, yes. He says, oh, you're called people call you the Chafetz Chaim, right? And he says, yeah. And he says, you're the one with the campaign about the ethics of speech, the books, the speeches, the pamphlets, the whole works. He says, yeah. So he says, why do you think you're more moral than we are? He says, you're not more moral than we are. No, Chafetz Chaim doesn't, what do you mean? He says, the reason I speak Lashon Hara is because I get pleasure from it right now. Correct? The reason you campaign against Lashon Hara is because you are going to get pleasure after you die in the world to come. He says, so the difference between you and me is about 50 years. He says, you are not more moral than I am. You are just more patient. You're willing to wait for your pleasure. I'm not. So, I mean, this is unbelievable chutzpah to that, but that's how the story goes. So the Chafetz Chaim does not know what to say. So this guy, one of the other guys there, says, I'll tell you what, Rabbi, if you can prove to us that you are sincere, you're in it not for the reward, we will make a commitment to learn one of your sforim. So Chafetz Chaim says, well, how can I prove that? I mean, what can I do? So they say, I'll tell you what, they pull out, one of them says, let's sit down, takes out a piece of paper. If you're willing to sign an agreement to say, I hereby declare to God that all reward that I get from my campaign regarding Lashon Hara, I don't want it. I don't want it. You prepared to sign that, Rabbi? If so, we'll learn one of your books. So the Chafetz Chaim says, yeah, I'm prepared to write that. So they start writing it. Then one of them says, oh, I know what you're thinking, Rabbi. You're thinking, think of the reward I'm going to get in the world to come for giving up my reward in the world to come. So we're going to write in the contract that you give up all reward, both direct and indirect, as a result of anything pertaining to the laws of Lashon Hara, either by action or inaction, pertaining to blah, blah, see preamble to agreement, blah, 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 right, etc. And they write this down, and the Chafetz Chaim says, okay. And they give him the pen, he's about to sign it, and one of them says, okay, we see you're sincere. They rip it up, they say, we're committed. We'll learn your sefer. An amazing story, right? And what it tells me is the Chafetz Chaim was following what the Rambam says. He was not in it. He was not trying to prevent these people from speaking Lashon Hara because he's going to get pleasure in the world to come. He's prepared to do this knowing that he will not get the pleasure in the world to come. That's the Chafetz Chaim's greatness. And there's a famous, that was a not well-known story. There's a famous story about the Gaon of Vilna. Apparently, Estrogium were hard to come by in Lithuania. Understandably, it's not exactly tropical. And there was a wealthy woman who actually had able to bring in some etrogim from Calabria in Italy, and she was selling them for an exorbitant price, which is the minhag. And basically, what happens is that the Gaon of Vilna sends a student to purchase an esrog for Sukkos. And she says, look, you can't afford these esrog. So the student says, no, the Gaon of Vilna, the Gaon wants an esrog, he'll pay anything you want. Not obviously, they're not, you know, experienced business people, okay, right? Do not say this in negotiations, right? But he says, he'll pay anything you want. She says, I'll tell you what I want. If your rabbi wants the esrog, I want his reward for doing this mitzvah on Sukkos. He wants the esrog, I get the reward for doing the mitzvah. So they sent word to the Gaon of Vilna, and he said, of course, there's no question. Ideal. And that Sukkos, they say, it was one of the happiest of his life. Why? He says, the one time he says, I know that I'm doing the mitzvah for the sake of the mitzvah. There's nothing in the back of my mind about reward. There's nothing in the back of my mind about the Olam Haba, because I gave it up. He says, Baruch Hashem, the best Sukkos. So that is the Rambam. Now, the Rambam does point out, the Torah does mention the idea of peace and security and prosperity and health and all that type of stuff, right? That's not to be shrugged off, right? So what is that about? So the Rambam says that's not the ultimate reward. Those are what he calls hasaras hamon'im. They are the things that prevent us from doing the mitzvahs. If we don't have peace and security and health and wealth, etc., it's very difficult to do the mitzvahs. So those are just the means to the end. They're not the actual mitzvah itself. Right, the fact that Jewish people need to live in peace and security in our land, etc., those are just the mechanisms that we require, the framework we require to do the mitzvahs. That's not the reward. He says, now you'll ask me. He says, what about in the prophets, in the Nevi'im, and in Chazal, the sages, they talk about the reward much more explicitly than the Torah. So the Rambam says, that's educational. He says, because you see, when you approach a child, and you tell the child who's 3, 4, what age they learn to read, I don't know. What age should they learn to read? Probably about 5 or 6. What age they actually learn to read, I don't know, 3. Probably useless, creates a lot of problems. Anyway, so you come to the kid, he's 5 years old, you say, do you want to learn Aleph Beis? And he says, no, I want to play. So you say, do you not understand? If you learn Aleph Beis, you'll be able to formulate words, you'll be able to read, you'll be able to accumulate the knowledge of Torah, right, through the understanding of these symbols, which actually represent letters and sounds, etc. And the kid's going to look at you like you're crazy, right? And he says, can I get a candy? I say, I'm talking to you about knowledge, and you're talking about a candy, right? Will you stop acting your age? So the kid, obviously, you have to speak to the kid about candy at that point, right? He gets a little older, he'll want something more advanced. He'll want some type of electronic device, right? He gets a little older, he'll want something else. But at a certain point, right, you don't need to do that anymore. So the Rambam says, Chazal, for educational reasons, are telling us and teach us and say, no, there are incentives. And they talk about these ideas, but really, the ultimate goal is to have our eyes focused not on the do this so that you'll get that, do this so you'll bring that, do this so you'll like, etc. No, do this because it's true. Do this because it's good. Do this because Hashem wants you to do it. That's the basic idea. And the Rambam understands that the Torah Shebichsav, the written Torah, that represents the ideal. And we look at we may not be at the ideal, but it's important to have a picture of what the ideal is so you can strive towards it. I remember there was a gym I used to go to in Yerushalayim many years ago. And in this gym, they used to utilize this idea. They had posters on the wall of these guys, like muscle-bound, like, you know, Jean-Claude Van Damme and Arnold Schwarzenegger, governor, sorry, right, etc. on the wall, right? And that was the ideal. And then in front of the machine, they'd have the pathetic reality. A mirror, right? So you can look at the mirror, oh my gosh, right? And then you look at the ideal, and you try to bridge the gap between the reality and the ideal. Lahavdil, that is what the Torah does. The ideal is the Torah Shebichsav, the written Torah, which doesn't even mention Olam Haba. And it wants us to bridge the gap between that and the ideal, and to get to that ideal, so we're doing the mitzvahs because they are true. That is answer number one. Number two, the Ibn Ezra and the Maharal both give a similar answer. And they say the following. Sometimes words are insufficient to describe something. On the contrary, sometimes when you use words, people will take ideas from their experience and they'll translate your words into their own experience as opposed to try to understand your experience. You understand what I'm saying? Like, I'll give you an example. Remember, one of my kids, who was at the time, I think, three, we were living in Toronto, and I just bought a swing set. And the swing set comes in a large, flat, square cardboard box. I'm sure you've seen them. You assemble them yourself. There are instructions written in some form of Taiwanese English, which is almost incomprehensible. And basically, it's in this flat, square cardboard box, which took up the entire roof rack of my car. And as I'm schlepping the thing off the car, and as my spine, as the hernia is just about to, just like that, right, the kid always chooses that moment to speak to you, right? That's how it is, right? So I'm like this, and he says to me, Abba, and I say, yeah, what is it? What do you want? And he says, he looks at this gigantic, square, flat cardboard box, and he says, Abba, and I say, yeah. He says, big pizza. Because you see, it's a square, flat cardboard box. So what comes in square, flat cardboard boxes? Pizzas. If this happens to take up the entire roof rack of our car, it is a big pizza. In other words, in his limited experience, so he's based, and we all do the same as my kid. We all do the same. We see someone, we always try to put something into the box of my experience, try and cram it into my experiences and to my, right? So now, as humans, we don't experience the purely spiritual. Everything we have is related, everything we experience related to the physical. It's through the filter of the senses. It's through the, on the contrary, that Mukubalim say that the senses, in a way, are actually filter. They are static, right? Pure perception would be completely spiritual. We don't have pure perception. We perceive things through the physical world. And so, therefore, to talk about Olam Haba, which is a purely spiritual world, would require using terms borrowed from this world. And if you use terms borrowed from this world, so there are two reactions that people could have. Either people could elevate themselves beyond their experience and beyond their vocabulary and understand that we're talking about something higher, or, and what's the most likely, people will drag the idea down into their experience. So if we use terminology for the world to come, which we have to use, the Torah would have to use physical terminology. There's no choice. What people would do is drag it down. Sometimes you describe an experience to someone, the more you talk about it, the worse it is. I remember telling a friend of mine about seeing some magnificent, magnificent sight, natural beauty, something like the Grand Canyon. And he says, okay, so it's like it's a big ditch. I said, no, you don't understand. It's not just a big ditch. It is enormous. There's a river at the bottom. Okay, it's a big drainage ditch. And the more I spoke about it, the worse it was. I mean, it was impossible to get through to this guy, you know, right? It's the type of thing that almost drives you to violence, right? Not, it actually did in that particular case, but it doesn't matter, right? So the Torah doesn't want to do it. The Ibn Ezra says the Torah knows what would happen. And actually, if you've read the history of religion, you will know that in many religions, exactly what happened. People spoke about spiritual ideas, probably thinking in spiritual terms, but using physical descriptions. And what did the followers start thinking? Physical stuff. You only have to look at the development of Islamic beliefs, and also in Christianity as well, and that's what you have. You have people who probably were talking about things which are spiritual, and then over the time, it just became lower and lower and lower and lower until you get just like, but heavily, heavily gross, crude, physical descriptions of something which is really spiritual. So the Ibn Ezra says the Torah would prefer not to even talk about it than to have that happen. It prefers to leave it beremez as a hint. It prefers dai l'chakima beremiza, because for a wise person, it's enough to have a hint. And for everyone else, even a hint's not going to help. So therefore, the Torah prefer not to use that. The Maharal says something very similar. He says, we don't have vocabulary to describe it. He says, we are, in a sense, like blind people, where the vocabulary of color is useless to describe things, right? They can't comprehend it because it's not part of their experience. Right? The best you can do is use analogies for music, vibrations, etc., etc., but you can't describe color if you don't have the experience of color. Like the famous story, probably not true, but where the Rambam was being tested, there were some opponents of the Rambam. They were jealous of his position as physician to Salah al-Din. And so some other doctors, they claimed to have cured a guy. They brought a guy in who was blind. They said, he's blind from birth and we'll cure him. Now, in fact, he was not really blind, and they temporarily, obscured his vision, and they showed that they were able to do this, and they to impress the Salah al-Din, the caliph. And the Rambam was pretty cool about this, and they say to the Rambam, would you like to examine him? The Rambam says, sure, yeah. So he pulls out a handkerchief, and he holds it up to the guy, and he says, what color is this? And the guy says, red. And the Rambam says, I've just refuted your claim. If he has been blind since birth, how does he know this is red? How could he possibly be able to? He's been seeing for 2 minutes and he now claims that this is red. How does he know? So that instantly refuted their claim and reinstated the Rambam as the superior intellect. The story is not true, but it's a cute idea, and it does illustrate this concept of the Maharal. So that's basically the Ibn Ezra and the Maharal in their understanding. Why doesn't the Torah speak about it? Either, as the Ibn Ezra says, the Torah does not want to risk us turning it into some type of Jewish vision of the world to come, 72 caterers, etc. Right? That's how we'd look at it. Right, the Torah would prefer to leave it unstated and leave it in the form of a remez, of a hint, rather than anything else. And, according to the Maharal, because simply there is no vocabulary to describe such a thing, the vocabulary comes from a field of experience that we don't have. Ayin lo yirasa elokim zulasechi aselim hakim lach. No eye has seen it, God, that which you made for those who expect and wait for you. And therefore, that is the second answer. Answer number three. Rabbeinu Bachya, Ibn Pakuda, and the Ramban. They both say the following. They say, the Torah does not need to describe something which is natural, obvious, and a clear consequence. It only needs to describe things which are supernatural and surprising. That is to say, the idea that our success as a people, the Jewish people as a whole, our success in the land of Israel, etc., is tied to our spiritual and moral level. That we know from the Torah. The Torah tells us if the Jewish people are doing X, Y, and Z, they're doing the Torah of the Mitzvahs, we have peace, we have security, we have prosperity. If we don't, we've had exiles and we've had destruction and so on and so forth. So there's a correlation. The Ramban says that correlation between the moral level of the Jewish people and our physical success is absolutely miraculous. Why is it miraculous? Because in the laws of nature, there is absolutely nothing that links morality to safety or success. Example, two people are walking along and the ground breaks away, there's a sinkhole. Right, one is a total tzaddik, complete, a wonderful philanthropist, etc. The other is a miser, a lowlife, a really nasty person. I guarantee they'll both fall with the accelerate at 9.8 meters per second squared till they hit the ground. It's not like gravity will suddenly, one guy will just float gently and the other guy will plummet, right, like in cartoons. You know, the guy who looks down, he falls. If you don't look down, you don't fall. Cartoon laws of physics, right? You only fall if you actually look down, right? And then the bottom half of the body falls faster than the top half, right, etc., right? So and then the elasticity, etc. There are certain rules about this. But basically, the idea here is, the Ramban says, I'm paraphrasing the Hebrew, but the Ramban says that any linkage between morality and spirituality on the one hand and health or wealth or security or success on the other hand is miraculous. That's miraculous. That the Torah has to tell me. The Torah, I would never figure that out.
The Torah hasn't told me that, because that's a very surprising thing. Because in the laws of physics, there's nothing to say that. In the laws of biology, there's nothing to say that. In the way Hashem created the world, there's nothing to say that. Because HaKadosh Baruch Hu created a world in order to have a world of free will. A world of free will requires that we do not see obvious linkage between my goodness and my success. If we'd see obvious linkage between those two things, we would not have free will. I thought that's clear, right? We'd be like rats, right? Or as my wife told me that in the college she went to, it was very liberal, they said you cannot say rats. They are non-human animal research participants. So we would be like non-human animal research participants running around the Skinner box, right? Pressing levers, right? You give tzedakah, gold brick falls next to you. You're nasty to someone, brick falls on your head. Right, that's it, right? So obviously, right, what would you do? I would walk around being nice. Why? Because I'm programmed that way. We'd basically be non-human animal research participants running around the Skinner box, and that is not a meaningful existence, not a meaningful life. That's not what Hashem wants. That's what we call Nahama de Kisufa. That's not what the world is about. And so therefore, HaKadosh Baruch Hu created a world in which there is no obvious linkage. So anytime there is a linkage, as in the case of the Jewish people and our success in Israel and our wars and so on and so forth, that linkage is miraculous. That's a miracle. That's a miracle. He says, however, the idea that when I become more refined, when a person becomes more similar to Hashem, when a person's soul craves and comes close to Hashem, that that person will have a better relationship with Hashem, that is what philosophers would call, well, duh. That is obvious, of course. It's a tautology. It's like saying, when you become closer to Hashem, you'll become closer to Hashem. The Torah doesn't need to tell me that. The Torah tells me things which are a chidush, right? That is to say, svara lamali kro, things which are obvious, I don't need a verse for. Things which are obvious, I don't need a pasuk, a verse for. So the Ramban and Rabbeinu Bachai both say an interesting idea. They say, Olam Haba is obvious. If you believe in Hashem, if you believe in the soul, of course there's Olam Haba. The whole idea of being here is to have a relationship with Hashem. And that relationship with HaKadosh Baruch Hu is the soul in a relationship with HaKadosh Baruch Hu without the interference and the static of the physical world of space and time and ego. He says, but the fact that you have built yourself to become more like Hashem and therefore you have a better relationship is obvious. With anyone, that's true. In order to have a good relationship with anyone, you need compatibility, you need similarity, you need to be like that person. In order to like that person, you need to be like them. And that's true in any area. Certainly it's true with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. I'm always reminded there was a competition a long time ago. Coca-Cola had a competition. You open the Coke bottle, you look inside the cap, and it says either you've won or it says try again. I actually had a guy at my house. He opens a Coke bottle. It says try again. So he closes it and he opens it and he closes it. Says, like, dude, this is not working. It's like, you know. So anyway, first prize in the competition at the time was that if you won the competition, you got to spend 5 days chilling with the Beastie Boys. It's a musical group. I assume the second prize was 10 days with them. Anyway, so you got to spend 5 days with the Beastie Boys. So I was thinking to myself, imagine if the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra was playing here in New York, conducted by the great German conductor Herbert von Karajan. So Herbert von Karajan's conducting the Berlin Philharmonic after he finishes a series of Beethovens. So he struts backstage, puts some Deutschmarks or Euros into the Coke machine, takes out a Coke, he looks at the lid and it says, you have won. That's German for winning. All right, you have won. And he looks at the sign and he says, 5 days with the Beastie Boys. So let me ask you a simple question. Right, Herbert von Karajan, conductor of the Berlin Philharmonic, has just won a prize of 5 days with the Beastie Boys. I mean, is this first prize for anyone? I mean, or is this condemnation to the depths of Gehinnom? The answer is B. So what we see here is that it's clear that in order to have the joy and the pleasure of a relationship with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, you need to be compatible with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. All the mitzvahs are all about being compatible with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, imitating Hashem. Lios doime, le'elokav, to be similar to Hashem. The Ramchal says this, the Rambam says this, many of our philosophers say this. That's the whole idea. And therefore the Ramban, Nachmanides, says you don't need to talk about that because that's what the whole Torah is about. He says, but the Torah does need to tell us that if the Jews as a whole do observe the Torah, then we will have incredible success in our homeland. And we will have peace and security and so on and so forth, because that's something which is a chidush, that's novel, that's surprising, that needs to be told. A similar answer is given by the author of the Sefer HaChinuch. It's anonymous, so someone from Barcelona who is a Levi. But anyway, so the Sefer HaChinuch, in his introduction, he says that if you believe in Hashem, and you believe in reward and punishment, you have to believe in world to come. He says, it's just logical. Where else is there going to be the reward and punishment? Is it conceivable that in divine justice, someone like Kurt Waldheim, who was a Nazi, who was responsible for eliminating the Jews of Salonika, and ends his life as a head of state, surrounded by friends and family, dying peacefully in his bed? No, it's inconceivable, right? What we believe is that right now, he is getting his due punishment. Right? And his victims are getting their due reward. But if you only look at life, we clearly a view of life which is just encompassing the 70, 80, 90 years of our life, we know that the soul is eternal, it's before and it's after. It continues. And that idea, the Sefer HaChinuch says, is type of obvious. He says it's a logical necessity. If you believe in Hashem, and Hashem is just, and you look at this world, you're going to have to tell yourself, obviously, there's got to be another existence. This is only a small slice of the pie of existence. What we know is this much. What we don't know is that much. And then we have Rabbi Yehuda Levi's answer, which is one of my favorites. My mother is English, and so I type of like, every time they pick up a cup, it's like your pinky has to be out. That's how you pick up a cup in England, right? Your pinky is out. So I asked her why they do that. She says, well, it's simple. If a peasant walks into the room, he can do this. England. Anyway, so Rabbi Yehuda HaLevi in the Kuzari is asked the question that we asked at the beginning by the king. As you probably know, the Kuzari al-Kazari, the book Kitab al-Kazari is a book which basically is a dialogue between a pagan king and initially a philosopher, then a Christian and a Muslim, and then finally, the bulk of the book is a dialogue between this pagan king and a rabbi. And the rabbi, eventually the king converts to Judaism, and hence we have the Khazars, and hence you have Jews who look like me with the blonde, blue-eyed type thing. Anyway, so now, so the Russell Crowe type, yeah. Anyway, so I'm often confused with him because of the Australian accent and everything else. So now, Rabbi Yehuda HaLevi is asked by the king asks Rabbi Yehuda HaLevi, he asked the rabbi, it's not Rabbi Yehuda HaLevi, but Rabbi Yehuda HaLevi's writing it, he asked the rabbi, he says, I don't get it. He says, the Christian and the Muslim gave me these amazing descriptions of the world to come. Elaborate, very beautiful, oh my gosh, I can hardly wait. And he says, and you, O Jew, didn't even mention it. You haven't even mentioned, in all of your introduction of Judaism to me, you have not mentioned the world to come. Right? In the opening paragraph of the Christian and the Muslim, that's what they talk about. So it's exactly the same question that all the Rishonim are asking on the Torah, this king is asking on the rabbi. Rabbi Yitzhak HaSangeri, traditionally. So Rabbi Yehuda HaLevi answers the following. He says this. He says, if I am certain of the truth of my Torah, if I am certain of the truth of our prophecy, then we can make predictions that you can check out. He says, if I'm not certain of my truth, or if I know that I'm lying, the type of predictions I'll make are predictions that you cannot check out. Let me elaborate. Let's say I was starting a new religion, the United Church of Becherology. In the Church of Becherology, basically the main principle is give me your money, but obviously I can't get you to do that without some type of threat or promise, and obviously I don't control the weather, I can't say a lightning will strike your house, because that might not happen. So what do I say? Gehinnom, Olam Haba, is I start telling you descriptions of the world to come. This is the reward you're going to get. Paint beautiful picture. Oh, wow, that sounds awesome. And if you don't, etc. And I paint horrific. Oh, my gosh, Dante's Inferno, the whole works, right? So now, am I in danger of contradiction if I make predictions about the world to come? No, it's a safe prediction. No one's going to come back from the dead and say, Becher doesn't know what he's talking about. I didn't give him a cent. I had a great time. No, I'm safe. It's a safe prediction. Sir Karl Popper, the great British philosopher of science, he once put it, he said, put it this way, he called this the idea of falsifiability. Sir Karl Popper said, if you come out with a statement which cannot be falsified, it's not open to checking, it's not open to falsification, it's not meaningful. It's not meaningful. But if I make a statement or a prediction which you can check out, you can test, you can falsify or verify, that's a meaningful statement. That's a statement which means something. And so therefore, in religions that Hashem did not communicate with, and they're lying, or maybe they're sincere, but they're not sure, what are the type of predictions they're going to talk about? Safe predictions, right? Predictions in the world to come. The Torah, which is true, what are the predictions the Torah makes? Exile. Worldwide diaspora, anti-Semitism, return to Israel, all of these are predictions which happen where? Right here in this world. You can check them out. You can look at the, whatever it is, 23 major predictions of the Torah. We can see that 21 of them, I think, has happened so far. Right, unbelievable. You can see the prediction of the Korban and the fulfillment. The prediction of the Korban and the fulfillment. The prediction of the exile and the fulfillment. The ingathering of the exiles, the fulfillment. The preservation of Torah, the derision of the Jewish people, the smaller numbers spread all over the world, etc., etc., etc. These are all things which are not safe predictions because the Torah is true. It's a sign of the truth of Torah that the Torah's predictions are not about the world to come, but are about this world. There's a statement which goes, Haroitzel shaker yarchike voisav. You want to lie? Make sure your witnesses live far away. In New Jersey, we say, if you want to lie, make sure your witnesses don't live. And basically, that is the case. That's why Kahanim could not go into a lot of buildings in Newark, right? But the basic idea here is that if you want to lie, make sure that all your predictions are about the world to come, because then all the witnesses are dead and you are totally safe. That, Rabbi Yehuda Halevi's answer so beautifully, the Torah's predictions are predictions which are verifiable, which you can check out, and which shall fulfill the proper criterion of meaningfulness, etc. Not that that's why Hashem said, oh, proper, right, let's fulfill that. But rather, it's because it's a choisama yishol HaKadosh Baruch Hu emes, the seal of Hashem is truth. And that seal actually is in this idea that the Torah only makes the predictions about this world, not the world to come. Finally, we come to Rav Yosef Albo in the Sefer HaIkarim. It's a very interesting idea. I'm going to get a little grammatical here. In the world to come, in Hebrew we call what? Olam Haba. Olam Haba. The world that literally means the world that comes. So Olam Haba. Now, what do we call this world? Olam Hazeh. So now, Olam Hazeh means this world. So grammatically, what's the word which is the opposite of Hazeh? This. In English, what's the opposite of this? That. This, that. So in Hebrew it would be Hazeh. What would be the opposite? Ahu, ahu, right? Azeh ahu, right? So it should be olam azeh olam ahu, right? This world, that world. So it's not set up as grammatical opposites. Our sages, as the Maharal says, kol divrei chachamim kachem, all the words of the sages are stated with very precise intention and very precisely, grammatically, etc. When they say olam hazeh, this world, and they don't say olam ahu, that world, or they could have said olam haba, the world that comes, or olam shehaya, the world that was. I mean, right? But it's not set up evenly. What's going on? Why is that so? So one possible answer here, I won't say this is the only answer, but one answer is the following. This is how Rabbi Moshe Shapiro, my Rebbe, explains it. That Olam Haba really means the world that comes from this world. That is to say, that everything we do in this world actually creates our existence in the next world. In a sense, we are continuously building our world to come. That's why it's olam, really, it's like a shortened phrase. Olam haba mitoch haolam hazeh. Really, it's the world that comes from this world. This world is not disconnected from the world to come. It's not like it's a separate existence. It's actually, we create who we are in the olam haba. We create ourselves in very much in the sense that we, and it's very interesting, it's almost slightly morbid, but it's interesting. In Mishnaic Hebrew, the word kever, we know in Hebrew, kever means grave. But in the Mishnah, the word kever also means womb. W-O-M-B. Womb. Psichas ha-kever. What is going on? What's the idea there? So Maral explains, because they both share a common purpose. They are both a transition point from one lower level of existence into another higher level of existence. And interesting, as we go from the womb into this world, that's a different level of existence. And as we also know, to a great degree, birth weight and health and many factors in the child are affected by what the mother does, eats, exercise, music, does she smoke, is she on drugs, right, does she drink alcohol, etc., does she listen to music, etc., well, you know, during pregnancy, this affects the child when they're born. In the same way, we, in a sense, are pregnant with our future self. We give birth to who, this explains my frequent cravings, but we are actually pregnant with the future self. We give birth to ourselves, and what we do here creates who we are in the continuation of our spiritual existence. Everything we do affects the soul and molds the soul. And this Rashi, it's actually a Rashi that tells us this, Rashi, beginning of Parshas Noach, very famous and beautiful Rashi. Rashi says, Eileh, it says in the Torah, Eileh told us Noach, these are the children of Noach. And then instead of telling us the children, the Torah says, Noach was a tzaddik. And then after it tells us that Noach was a tzaddik, Tamihayev Adoroisav, it then says he had three sons, Shem, Ham, and Yafes. So Rashi is bothered by the fact that the Torah says these are the children of Noach. Instead of telling me his children, it digresses and gives me a parenthetical. Oh, he was also righteous. Then it tells me his children. So Rashi gives two explanations. The second explanation concerns me. The second explanation, Rashi says, is to teach us Ikar told Osehem Shel Tzadikim, the primary offspring of a righteous person, Maasehem, is their righteousness, their actions. That's your primary offspring. Because as the Maharal explains in Gur Aryeh, your child is not yours. There are three partners in the child. Father, mother, HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So no one can ever claim that the child's mine. No one. But your actions, a result of your free will decision, they're really yours. You are your own child. Reba McEntire said it well, right? She said, you are your own child. Don't forget to be good. It's never too late to have a good childhood. Right? You are your own child. Don't forget to be good. No doubt she was alluding here to the Maharal. And I mean, she is from the Bible Belt. But clearly, this idea is that we actually, and that's how it remotes, and that actually also explains another little grammatical feature, interesting anomaly. We are told, Kol Yisrael Yeshlem Chelek Le'olam Haba. Which, if you translate that, look in the Siddur, look at the translation. How is it translated? All of Israel has a portion in the world to come. Incorrect. It does not say, Kol Yisrael Yeshlem Chelek Be'olam Haba. That would be correctly translated as, all Jews have a portion in the world to come. It does not say, Be. What does it say? Le. So how do you translate Le'olam Haba? Doesn't mean in, it means towards the world to come. So the way Reb Chaim Volozhiner explains this is that everything we do, a portion of everything we do, has an impact on the creation of us and of our environment and of ourselves and our relationships in the Olam Haba. So the whole Torah is one idea. What's the whole Torah is? How to live here so that you can actually develop yourself, the world that comes from this world, for the next level of existence. So, The Torah does not speak about Olam Haba. Why doesn't Torah speak about Olam Haba? Because the way the Rav Yosef Elba would say it, because that's all the Torah speaks about. That is the subject of the entire Torah, how to live in this world, taking into account the spiritual component of the actions. A lot of people go through life in this world, they only think in terms of the physical impact, meaning how many calories, how many kilojoules, etc., etc. That's it. The fact of the matter is, if that's your whole calculation of life, you're missing out on a huge component of what life is about. If you pick up a 1 kilo, or a 2 kilo object and raise it 1 meter, so you could look at that and you could say, you could measure it in terms of how much work I've done, force times displacement, right, work out the mass and so on and so forth, etc. And you'll say, however, if that 2 kilo object was a small child and you were picking up the baby to comfort them and you raise them out and you comfort them, can you measure that only in terms of the amount of kilojoules you expended? Does that make sense? Ogden Nash said it beautifully, and I can't remember the exact language he used because I heard it in Hebrew from Rav Moshe Shapiro initially, right? But hearing Ogden Nash in Hebrew from Rav Moshe Shapiro is an experience, right? But Ogden Nash said something to the effect of, if you see a drop of water and you put it under a microscope and you can test the salt in that water and you can figure out that it's a human tear, he says, you still know nothing about that tear. You know how much salt is in it, and that's it. But he says, is it a tear of joy? Or is it a tear of sorrow? Is it a tear of love or a tear of hatred? Tear of anger? Tear of disappointment? A tear of jealousy? A tear of pride? What is it? Right? All those, he says, the physical examination doesn't tell you. Of course, today, actually, you can actually tell from the tear. But Ogden Nash did not know that. But all that is really part of another dimension, which you totally ignore if you only look at it in terms of the drop of water. I think it was William James who once said, if I would invite you to my house and say, for $5, sir, would you like to come and witness some horse's hair being scraped over cat gut in my home? You'd say, you are a weird person. And I would say, well, don't you want to hear the string quartet playing some Mozart eine kleine Nacht music in my house? Because I just described a violin, right? Horsehair over cat gut. Okay. It's just, if you describe it only as the material components, right, that's losing a tremendous amount of it. If I say it's music, that's the spiritual component. So in the same way, Olam Hazeh, this world, Olam Haba is the music produced by the cat gut and horse's hair of this world. And that the Torah, the mitzvahs, and everything else is how to properly tune our soul into the production of that music, how our soul can be part of that orchestra, and how our soul can be developed so that Olam Haba, that the world that comes from this world, is a beautiful and amazing and harmonious world and a relationship with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So therefore he would say, Rabbi Yosef Alba would say, that's really what the whole Torah is talking about. Your question doesn't even start. Because what is a mitzvah if not that? Mitzvah's not utilitarian. When you light candles on Shabbos, on Erev Shabbos, it's not utilitarian. We have got fluorescent lights. We've got all types of lights. I don't need candles. I can see fine without the candle. Right? I put on tefillin. I'm not doing anything utilitarian. It doesn't not help me one iota in the physical world to put leather around my arm. None of these things, putting a mezuzah on the door, doesn't do anything in this world. It's a spiritual idea. And the spiritual idea, every single mitzvah, is indeed part of that aspect of the development of the soul and the development of that relationship with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So we went through 5 or 6 of the various answers, and there are more, but we'll be here all evening if we cover all of them. And so we have the Rambam who says the Torah doesn't mention Olam Haba because the Torah wants us to be altruistic. Lasso, he says, Hatov, Mishum Shu Tov, to do that which is good because it is good. Esa MS, Mishum Shu MS, and that which is true because it is true. He doesn't want us to be looking at continuously and saying, how many points do I get for that? How many box tops do I have to send into HaKadosh Baruch Hu? Right? Proof of purchases. You know, that's not a mitzvah, it's not a proof of purchase. That's not what it is. It's a relationship and it's a commandment of Hashem. And then we had the Ibn Ezra, the Maharal, who talk about the idea of words cannot contain Olam Haba, Maharal, and the Ibn Ezra who says not only do they not contain Olam Haba, but the words that would be used would end up creating a distortion of it in the minds of the vast majority of people. One in a million people would understand, and the rest of us would say, oh, cool, pizza, right? That's what we'd say. And we have Rabbeinu Bachya and the Ramban who say that Olam Haba, right, or rather, the Torah only tells us that which is a chidush, the connection of our morality, our spirituality to our success, that's a chidush, that's a miracle, that's amazing. That's something the Torah needs to tell me. But the idea that if I develop my relationship with Hashem, I'll have a better relationship with Hashem, that is obvious. Torah doesn't need to tell me that. We had Rabbi Yehuda Levi, who says that it's a mark of the truth of the Torah, that the Torah's predictions are not in Olam Haba, as other religions, but it's in Olam Hazeh, because we know that we're telling the truth. So therefore the predictions are here where you can check them out. They're not in the world to come where the witnesses are all dead. And then we had Rabbi Yosef Albo, who tells us that really that is the central thesis of the Torah, is the creation of ourselves. The person that will be born into the next level of existence is created by my diet, my exercise, i.e. my mitzvahs and my Torah in this world. As Reba says, you are your own child. Don't forget to be good. It's never too late to have a good childhood. Thank you very much and good evening.